Good morning. We welcome you in Jesus' name as we come to worship our Lord and Savior. Over these next couple of weeks, while our organ is being repaired, we're going to use the piano to guide and lead us in our worship today. Apologize to those online. We're having some sound technical difficulties, so it might be a little bit harder for you guys to hear online, but we're trying our best, hopefully, to get that fixed for next week. But we're glad that you're here to worship with us today. To continue with our service, I invite you to stand. Today we gather in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Today's psalm begins with a plea to God, and then announces God's promised salvation. We now use Psalm 85 as we confess our sins and hear God's forgiveness for Jesus' sake. Lord, you were favorable to your land. You forgave the iniquity of your people. You withdrew all your wrath. Restore us again, O God of our salvation. Will you be angry with us forever? Will you not revive us again? Show us your steadfast love, O Lord. We confess we are sinners and ask for your mercy, O Lord. Let me hear what God the Lord will speak. For he will speak peace to his people and to his saints. Surely his salvation is near to those who fear him. Steadfast love and faithfulness meet. Faithfulness springs up from the ground. Yes, the Lord will give what is good. Righteousness will go before him. The steadfast love and faithfulness of our God is endless. For the sake of our Lord Jesus Christ and his sacrifice for all of our sins, God declares us to be his own children and has opened the kingdom of heaven to all believers. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Thanks be to God. Amen. We join in singing your opening hymn, Lord, Open Now My Heart to Hear. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O Lord, you gave such faith to your prophets that they listened and boldly spoke what they heard you say to them. Grant that we hear what you have to say now and, confident of your promised salvation, that we speak words of comfort and peace in a world that desperately needs both. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated as we continue with the scripture readings.
Our Old Testament reading today is taken from Amos chapter 7. Amos is a prophet that we don't hear from very much. We're going to talk about the King Jeroboam in here. Jeroboam was a king of Israel to the northern kingdom. The kingdom of Israel had split at this time. Rehoboam was the king of the south, son of Solomon, the king that you probably remember very well, and Jeroboam became king of the north. They split because of very high taxation from the courts of Solomon and Rehoboam. So when we read this, we keep this in mind that Jeroboam was of the north. God pronounces in this judgment on Jeroboam because Jeroboam was leaving God completely and leading his people away from the true worship of God. So when we look at this reading, Amos, a prophet who was chosen of very lowly state, he was just a herdsman, keeper of fig trees and so forth, is to go out and speak against what Jeroboam is saying. And he's accused by Amaziah, the priest, of being an insurrectionist. He's trying to get the priest, who is a priest of God, but holds his position, which is under Jeroboam, higher than his faithfulness to his Lord. And so we'll read this scripture verse, understanding that I think we don't hear much about Amos nor Jeroboam, so that's why it took a little length of time to help us understand it maybe a little better. This is what the Lord God showed me. Behold, the Lord was standing beside a wall built with a plumb line in his hand. And the Lord said to me, Amos, what do you see? And I said, a plumb line. Then the Lord said, behold, I am setting a plumb line in the midst of my people Israel. I will never again pass by them. The high places of Isaac shall be made desolate, and the sanctuaries of Israel shall be laid waste. And I will rise against the house of Jeroboam with the sword. Then Amaziah, the priest of Bethel, sent to Jeroboam, king of Israel, saying, Amos has conspired against you in the midst of the house of Israel. The land is not able to bear all his words. For thus Amos has said, Jeroboam shall die by the sword, and Israel must go into exile away from his land. And Amaziah said to Amos, O seer, go flee away from to the land of Judah, and eat bread there, and prophesy there, but never again prophesy at Bethel. For it is the king's sanctuary, and it is his temple, and it is a temple of the kingdom. Then Amos answered and said to Amaziah, I was no prophet, nor a prophet's son, but I was a herdsman and a dresser of sycamore figs. But the Lord took me from following the flock, and the Lord said to me, go prophesy to my people Israel. This is the word of the Lord. Our second reading is taken from Ephesians chapter 1. Here, Paul predestination and how we are as Christians predestined to be children of God. And our destination lies in one thing, the sacrifice of Jesus Christ and what Jesus did for us on the cross. And those who believe that they are sinners and they need that salvation. This is what Paul talks about in the letter to the Ephesians, are predestined to heaven. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him. In love, he predestined us for the adoption as sons through Jesus Christ, according to the purpose of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace, with which he blessed us in the beloved, Jesus. In him, we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace, which he lavished upon us in all wisdom and insight, making known to us the mystery of his will according to his purpose, which he set forth in Christ as a plan for the fullness of time, to unite all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth. In him we have obtained an inheritance, having been predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things according to the counsel of his will, so that we who were the first to hope in Christ might be to the praise of his glory. In him you also, when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and believed in him, were sealed with the promise of the Holy Spirit, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until we acquire possession of it to the praise of his glory. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. I invite you to stand for the reading of the gospel. Our gospel reading for today is from Mark chapter 6. King Herod heard of it, for Jesus' name had become known. Some said, John the Baptist has been raised from the dead. That is why these miraculous powers are at work in him. But others said, he is Elijah. And others said, he is a prophet, like one of the prophets of old. But when Herod heard of it, he said, John, whom I beheaded, has been raised. For it was Herod who had sent and seized John and bound him in prison for the sake of Herodias, his brother Philip's wife, because he had married her. For John had been saying to Herod, it is not lawful for you to have your brother's wife. And Herodias had a grudge against him and wanted to put him to death. But she could not, for Herod feared John, knowing that he was a righteous and holy man, and he kept him safe. When he heard him, he was greatly perplexed, and yet he heard him gladly. But an opportunity came when Herod, on his birthday, gave a banquet for his nobles and military commanders and the leading men of Galilee. For when Herodias' daughter came in and danced, she pleased Herod and his guests. And the king said to the girl, ask me for whatever you wish, and I will give it to you. And he vowed to her, whatever you ask me, I will give to you, up to half of my kingdom. And she went out and said to her mother, for what should I ask? And she said, the head of John the Baptist. And she came in immediately with haste to the king and asked, saying, I want you to give me at once the head of John the Baptist on a platter. And the king was exceedingly sorry, but because of his oaths and his guests, he did not want to break his word to her. And immediately the king sent an executioner with orders to bring John's head. He went and beheaded him in the prison, and brought his head on a platter and gave it to the girl, and the girl gave it to her mother. When his disciples heard of it, they came and took his body and laid it in a tomb. This is the gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. We confess our faith together in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated as we join in our next hymn. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts gathered here today be acceptable in your sight, O Lord and our Redeemer. Amen. So today we have the story in the Gospel of Mark of the beheading of John the Baptist. I mean, quite a striking type story. And so what I'd like to do for you for a moment here is I'm going to show you a video about this story. I'd see a little more shock in your faces there. No, I'm not going to show you that. That would be a little bit too much. But think about it for a moment. This is not the typical type of story that you think you would hear on a Sunday morning. In fact, this is the type of story that Well, maybe it would be watching Game of Thrones or some other show on television with all this intrigue and evil things going on and people underhandedly doing things. I mean, that's the story that's going on here. And yet, it is right here in the Gospel of Mark for us. So why? Why is this story here? Why does it happen in this way? I mean, Mark is recording these words by the power of the Holy Spirit specifically to teach us something. Things aren't just thrown in there for no particular reason. They're there for us to see. Now, on the surface, we can see it as just kind of history. You know, what happened to John the Baptist? And what happened to people who had kind of turned away, in a sense, from the religious elite who had challenged Rome? And so we have a historical fact of what happened to John the Baptist there. But I think there's a lot more here going on for us, and a reminder for us of the importance of focusing on Jesus, especially when we recognize our sinful condition. You see, I really think this is a story that reminds us again about sin. It is a shocking story of sin. But there's all kinds of different things caught up in this story, more than just for the shock value of what's going on here. I mean, we have Herodias, who really doesn't like John the Baptist because of the marriage that had happened between Herod and his brother's wife, Philip, Herodias. She didn't like this. And so we have that underhanded thing going on there, and she wants to get rid of John the Baptist. And then we have Herod. Oftentimes we see Herod as an evil character in the text, someone who is doing all these things against the people of God. In fact, it is Herod in which Jesus goes to in the night in which he was betrayed. And Herod, you know, sends him off to Pilate, and they eventually have Jesus killed. But if you look closely at the text today, Herod actually had questions and was wondering about John. He also was caught up in his role as this kind of kingly role that he had, though he was a puppet to Rome. He was afraid of the people, and he was afraid of John, actually. But the text talked about how he was perplexed, but also glad to have John with him, even when he had him arrested. I think he was thinking he would have John closer to him. I think Herod was actually interested in what John had to say. But as the story plays out, we see that Herod gave in to the things of this world, gave in to his power, gave in to sin, gave in to, well, things he thought had more control in his life than listening to God and the power of God. And so this story is a reminder of the power of sin in our lives. And as much as we might be shocked by this story, I think we need to realize and recognize, well, sin is at play in our lives as well. Any of those things are things that are in our sinful hearts as well. And so it's a wake-up call again to be reminded about our sin. But we need to put it also into some sort of perspective here. So sometimes we get paranoid about sin, paranoid about the things of this world. Paranoid so much so that we are constantly worrying about how bad things are. And constantly worried about how bad things may become for our own selves. And so I have this picture up here where you see it looks like they're trying to rescue this woman from falling off this, what appears to be, huge cliff. I mean, the ocean is probably 500 feet below, it looks like there. And so that is something to be panicked about, something to worry about. But perspective sometimes is an important thing. You see, this is actually a tourist trap. And if you just pan your camera the right way, you look like you're over a cliff, but really you're only about 3 feet off the ground. So this is a reminder for us on one side that sometimes we focus too much on the difficulties of this world and the hard things that are going on in this world, and worried that maybe it's going to overtake us. But as we know from the Gospel of Mark, that Jesus is victorious. Yeah, we hear the story of Herod and John the Baptist who lost his life at that point, but Jesus is still victorious in the story. If we only had that peace there with John the Baptist, then our perspective would be, this is a horrible world for us to live in, and sin is running rampant. But the rest of the book reminds us that Jesus is the answer to that. So again, sometimes we get so caught up in the difficulties of the things of this world, we forget that God is always there for us. So that's one side, one negative way that we can take sin in our life. But there's another way that we sometimes take sin, and we don't take it seriously enough. We don't recognize that, well, God is at work in this sinful world. You know, a lot of times what we want to do is we think we're taking sin seriously by trying to remove ourselves from the sin of this world. And trying to remove ourselves from it, then we think that we are keeping ourselves from the evil and the horrible things that are happening. But in the sense of removing ourselves, we're actually removing ourselves from the possibility of how God is at work. How God is at work in all things of this world. Yeah, even the sinful, horrible things, God still is victorious and wins through that. But a lot of times we as Christians want to kind of hide ourselves and isolate ourselves from that and just totally trust that, you know, God's going to take care of us, but we're going to hide ourselves from all this evil that's in the world. Well, I want to tell you a story here, and it goes along with this picture. And I know you've heard this story before, but I want to read it to you. This is the original story. There once was a man who lived in a two-story house. The house was near a river, and unfortunately, the river began to flood. As the river rose, warnings were given via the radio and the TV. Large jeeps drove through the area to evacuate people. As a jeep drove to the man's house, he was told, "You are in danger. Your life is at stake. You must evacuate. Get in the jeep. Let us help you evacuate." "No," the man replied from the doorstep. "I have faith. I will be okay. The flood won't get me. God will take care of me." The water continued to rise. Soon the man was on the second floor. A boat was going through the area and arrived at the man's house. Rescuers made every effort to convince the man to take action so that his life would be saved. "You are in danger. Your life is at stake. You will drown in the flood." "No worries," said the man. "I have faith. Everything is going to be okay. Even though the flood is rising, I will be fine. God will take care of me." The flood continued to rise. The man went to the roof to avoid the rising water. A helicopter pilot sees him on the roof and hovers above the man. Using a megaphone, the pilot tries to convince the man to grab the rope ladder, which was dangling above his head. "You are in danger. The flood is still rising. You will drown if you do not grab the rope ladder. Let us help you." "No worries," said the man. "I will be fine. Yes, the flood is higher, but I have faith. God will take care of me." The flood rises. The man drowns. At the gate to heaven, the man says to God, "I have faith, but you let me die. Why?" To which God replies, "I sent you a jeep and a boat and a helicopter. What more could I have done for you?" Sin is very real, but I think sometimes we want to hide that in our lives. We want to show that we have our lives all together. We want to look perfect. We want to keep ourselves separated from the world. And yet God says to be in the world. But we're so afraid of the sin that is in the world, and we're so afraid of the things that are going on. But in our hiding, I think sometimes we miss that the danger's right there with us. Just like that frog sitting on that alligator. Because sin's right here, too. And we need to take sin seriously. But if we take it seriously and also recognize the forgiveness that God gives to us, well, it puts us in a different place. Yes, we avoid sin, but we don't need to run from it. We don't want to sin, but we only do that by the power of the Holy Spirit. But we don't need to be afraid, because God has overcome these things. I think sometimes in our hiding, sometimes in our putting on our perfect face, we actually are doing ourselves more disservice because we don't recognize the sin within us. But this is the amazing thing. The more we see the sin within us, the more beautiful Jesus' salvation is for us. You know, sin is just a little thing in our lives. Why do we need a Savior? But if we're overwhelmed to the point of drowning in sin, God's salvation in Jesus Christ is a miraculous and wonderful and a desperately needed thing. I think a story like this with Herod and John the Baptist reminds us that sin has truly broken this world. Not that we need to be afraid of it because we have a Savior, but also not that we need to hide from it because we need to see the reality of sin in our lives. But the reality is, God has overcome the sin that is there. He invites us to follow where he leads us. He invites us to trust him no matter where we go, no matter the difficulties that we face. I mean, another way of looking at the story of John the Baptist is that, yes, he died, but guess where he is because of Jesus? In eternal life. Even when the worst things can happen, God is always there for us. Maybe it's also a warning to not be like Herod, that we're so worried about the things of this world that we miss that opportunity to hear and see and know of Jesus' love and grace and mercy to us. The story reminds us of the reality of this world. We are broken by sin, and there's nothing we can do about it. But God has done it all for us in Christ Jesus. We don't need to whitewash the story. We don't need to run and hide from it. The reality is we are sinners and we live in a sinful world. But the reality also is that Jesus has forgiven our sins. May we trust in him and turn to him in all that we do. Amen. We continue now by bringing forward our offerings. I invite you to stand as we continue with the prayers of the church. Let us go to God in prayer for the church around the world, for the nations of this earth, and all who call to him in their various needs. Heavenly Father, we do thank and praise you that in the midst of this sinful and broken world, that you have redeemed us through Christ Jesus. May we marvel and wonder at that joy that we have of what Jesus has done for us. And not take that for granted, but to know and trust that in you alone we have salvation. Lord, we also pray for those who are in need of your healing touch. We pray for Joanne, for Ron, for Janet, for Bill, for Marty, and for Stella, for Dennis, and for Robert, for Victoria, for Carrie, for Kayla, for Joyce, and for Jason, for Cindy, for Jelani, for Christy, for Art and for Sharon, for baby Claire, for Jim, for Danielle, for Jessica, for Matthew, for Roxanne, for Profe Maria, and for Gail. Lord, for these individuals, we pray that you would bring your comfort and peace in their time of need. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we pray for those who are facing uncertain times, whether it be a loss of a job or a loss of income, whether it be facing a surgery or uncertain tests ahead, whether it be facing difficulties within a family. Lord, in all these situations and many more that we face, we pray that you would bring your comfort, your peace, and your wisdom. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we pray for our leaders in our community, in our state, in our nation, in our world. For Lord, you have established governments to maintain order in this world. May they truly lead with wisdom and guidance from you. And may we serve as good citizens of each of the communities that you have placed us into, knowing and trusting that when we follow your wisdom and guidance, that you truly bring a peace that passes all understanding, even in this sinful world. Lord, in your mercy, we pray for those who are lost, who do not know you as Lord and Savior. Lord, we pray that their hearts would be open to hear the word of salvation. But Lord, we pray that you send us out into the world to proclaim that message of salvation. Just as you sent the disciples two by two, you continue to send your church into this world to proclaim the words that you are our Lord and Savior. Help us, Lord, not to hide in fear from this world, but to go so that others too can hear of your Son, Jesus Christ, and have their hearts opened as well to the love that you have shown to them. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we thank you for all that you have truly done for us, all the blessings that you give us in this earthly life. Lord, we know there are times that we have plenty and times that we don't, but all of it, Lord, we know is from you. Help us to trust in you, Lord, with our very lives, and the very things that we need, we know that you give to us, for you know the best for our lives. May we trust you in all the things that we do in this life. Lord, in your mercy, into your hands we commend ourselves and all for whom we pray, trusting in your grace for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Taught by our Lord and trusting his promises, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. Amen. You may be seated. Again, we thank you for worshiping with us today. We continue to have worships on Sunday and on Wednesdays, and we're glad that we're able to offer that to you and the opportunity for you to worship with us. So, Rebecca, if you have an announcement this morning, if you come up to the mic, please.
I just want to say thank you so much for all the donations that you gave in the past couple weeks. I will continue to put donations that you can give up on the board, but without all your help, we wouldn't be able to do all the activities in our summer camp. And even if you can't donate, just your thoughts and prayers are much appreciated.
Thank you, Rebecca. Yeah, this year we have our summer camp. That's kind of a runs from like 7:30 in the morning until about 5:30 in the evening for children that need that time. And so it's a wonderful opportunity for us also to kind of reach out to those children with the love of Jesus, not only the care for that day, but also the love of Jesus. And we've been able to do crafts and other things. So yes, we really appreciate those gifts that you have given. If there are things that you need prayer requests, just needing to talk about some things, don't hesitate to reach out to us here at St. John. You can contact us in multiple ways, but we are here for you and to help you along your faith journey. So don't hesitate to do that so that we can stay connected with each other. Also, our website continues to have information there, help you with some of the different things going on with that, and then also our email newsletter that comes out weekly. Also, we have a printed version of that too that you can pick up, hopefully picked up today if you're here on site. Thank you also for the offerings that you give. Our organ repairs are because of generous gifts that you have given. We have multiple ways that you can give, but what a wonderful way to show that we are in gratitude of God's blessings to us by using them to further his kingdom. So thank you. Next important thing is this coming Wednesday, right after our worship service, so roughly about 7:45-ish, we will have our voters meeting. And this voters meeting is an important one because it is about our budget. So every year about this time, we are ready to vote on our budget for the next year. Usually happens during the summertime because we have to get ready for the next school year. And so this July 14th, so after our worship service, we invite you to come. There are copies of the proposed budget for you to take if you'd like. In the back, we have a one sheet, actually it's front and back sheet, that just hits the highlights of our budget for the next year, our income and our expected expenses. If you want a little bit more detailed one, there is a six-page one as well that you can pick up. So pick up whichever one you would like to look at. But that will be this next Wednesday, and an important meeting for that. Okay, any other announcements from anyone this morning? Again, we're glad that you're here today and enjoy the day. Enjoy this opportunity to hear God's word, and may it truly edify you and kind of fill you with his word throughout this week. Let us stand then as we sing our final hymn together, How Firm a Foundation.